last class we had looked at what are the various factors. We just started with the looking at the factors which influence the selection of various methods, and the two major factors which we had talked about were the soil, how the soil type influences the selection of method, and then we looked at how the topography influences the irrigation methods. The other factors which can be included, which have impact on the selection of irrigation methods, include climate. In the case of climate, how does it influences the irrigation method? Because as we have seen in the previous topics, the climate is the one which influences the evapotranspiration requirements. Now, if your climate is such that the evapotranspiration requirement is very high because of the climate, then you might not be in a position to choose a method which needs sufficient amount of water or sufficient quantity of water, because in the case where your frequency is high, the frequency of irrigation or the number of times irrigation has to be provided, because what you do is that you are replenishing the deficit, and the rate at which the deficit is being created is quite high. Because of this high rate, the frequency at which the moisture has to be supplied will also be high. So consequently, you might not be in a position to choose a method which cannot be repeated very often. So that is how the climate will influence the choice of the method, because there are some methods where you have complete control on the application, the number of times the applications can be made, whereas there are some methods where the control is not as good as with some other methods. So these methods where you have to wait for the next application because of the complications in the layout of the system or the distribution and network of the system, those methods might not be in a position to be getting the priority or getting the selection in terms of the climatic conditions. So climate can be in some situations can be very very influencing factor in the selection. On the other side, this is one aspect of the climate where we have said in general that those methods which are dependent on the gravity flow, they might not be highly suitable in some situations. You cannot generalize. But let's see the other extreme. Let me say that if I have very windy conditions, the wind velocities are very high. In this climate where the wind velocities are very high, you might find that the other methods which are suitable, which are capable of having a very high level of frequency of irrigation, you might not be in a position to, for example, let me say that this you are using under windy conditions a method which is sprinkler irrigation method. Now, if you use sprinkler irrigation method, because of the wind effect, there will be a lot of moisture which will be drifted away from the target of the target level. If your fields are somewhere here, you might find that because of the wind conditions, you might want to apply water here in this area, over this zone. your water might be drifted and it might be getting applied. Some water might be getting applied here, but there can be some portion of the water might be getting drifted. So there can be losses which are the spray losses, which we'll deal with subsequently. They might increase to an extent that this particular method under very high windy conditions might not become the natural choice. You might have to look for some other method if the conditions are not suitable for this method because of the windy conditions. So you have to look at the various combinations in terms of the climate. What is the overall combination of the various factors which are influencing the climate and thereby in turn influencing the evapotranspiration, and whether you can choose that specific method. If you choose that method, what will be the implied other implied factors which will influence the various aspects of irrigation. Let's go to the other factors which can influence the selection of the method of irrigation. Water supply. Because in any irrigation, there are some factors related to the water supply which have to be looked into, and these factors vary from the, when you say water supply, the three attributes of water supply which you'll have to consider. Well, what is the quality of water? What is the quantity of water? And duration for which that quantity of water is available. Now these three aspects can in different circumstances, they can be very influencing factors in deciding what type of method should be suitable under those set of circumstances. Let's take the example that if your quality of water is not very good, you might need a method where you can enhance the moisture level of the soil, or you can keep the moisture level of the soil quite high. Because if we'll be using that method which can be applied in small quantities, where the water can be, even you can afford to supply the water in small quantities, then as we have discussed earlier, that in those situations where the moisture content is very low, the salt accumulation in the soil can be detrimental. The ill effects of the salt accumulation of the in the soil can be less detrimental if the moisture content of the soil can be kept at a higher level. So if you have that problem, then it will be better to choose that method which can afford to let the moisture content of the soil be at a higher level, or in some cases where you can have sufficient quantity of moisture so that the salts which have accumulated in the top layer of the soil can be depleted and they can be pushed into the lower levels. Similarly, in the case of quantity of water, now there are some methods where you cannot apply the water if the quantity of water is very low, because of the fact that the distribution of water over the field will be very poor. If you're, let's assume that if your quantity of water is small. Now, quantity can be in terms of the total volume, or it can be in terms of the rate at which the water is available. That is where the duration comes into picture. Now, when you look at the quantity, you might have to club it along with the duration. Because if the rate at which the water is available is very low, but is available for a very longer period, you might have the same quantity covered in terms of volume if the rate of water was very high but for a very short duration. So, looking at the quantity in terms of volume as well as the duration for which is available, your method of your choice of method of irrigation might be constrained. Because there are some methods where you cannot go below a level in terms of the rate of water available. If the rate of water available is very, very small, some of the methods might not be suitable for the application of water onto the field. This cannot be looked at as a standalone criteria. You have to look at the other parameters, like what is the slope of the field, what is the soil type. So it cannot be, when you say quantity and duration, you cannot look at these attributes in isolation. You'll have to look at the other aspects of the topography of the field, the slope of the field, the type of the soil which is available. But the supply, the water supply in terms of its quantity, in terms of its quality, in terms of the rate of water availability, they will certainly influence the method of irrigation to be selected. Then crop. Crops will also influence which crops you want to cultivate, which are the crops in question. So depending on the type of crop which you want to irrigate, the method of irrigation will be dependent on the type of crop also. For example, there are various aspects of the crops, how they influence the method. The first thing you can think in terms of the sensitivity of the crop to the inundation of water. There are some crops which are very sensitive if the water stands on the ground for a sufficient period, and because of the low aeration available, if the water will be standing, you will get the saturation conditions or conditions which are close to saturation. All the air will be displaced and it will be replaced with water. So under those circumstances, there are some crops which get influenced in terms of reduction in the yield. Those crops, if you are cultivating those crops, then you cannot choose a method of irrigation which can induce the conditions of saturation, or where the water might be standing for some time and reducing the aeration in the soil. So if you have such crops, you will go in for a method where you have the application done in such a manner that the water is not possible for the water to stand beyond a certain period, which is not detrimental for the crop production. Similarly, the type of crop, how much they grow in horizontal direction and in vertical direction, in terms of how much the resistance they provide to the flow of water. Whenever you will have the crop grown into the field, you will find that as the crop grows, there will be spread of their stem. There will be it depends what type of crop it is. If it is the fodder crop, it will be so close growing that you might find that the resistance to the flow of water will be so much that it might not be possible for the water to move at a very, very fast rate and go to the next subsequent areas in the field. In that situation, you might choose a method where you don't have very elongated fields, because otherwise you might find that most of the water which has been applied, it just keeps on infiltrating onto the upstream edge of the, if this is a field, and if you are applying the water in the upstream end and is flowing towards the downstream end, if there's a lot of crop, the density is very high, you might find that the unevenness of the distribution of water will be too much. So you cannot choose a method of irrigation which needs very long fields. You might have to go in for a method, because when you say methods, the methods are distinguished on the basis of the shapes of the fields, the sizes of the fields, how they are laid. All the methods which we'll be covering just immediately after this, you'll find that the methods are not the method of application only. Their differentiation is with respect to the shapes and sizes of the fields also. So this, in this particular situation, you'll find that the crops can influence to an extent the selection of the method, what type of method should be suitable to the specific crops. Then another aspect you can even consider, that the value of the crops, can also influence the method to be applied. If the crop is a high value crop, in that situation you might find it quite reasonable to invest more money, select a method which is more efficient, but it needs more investment. So you might be able to justify that investment depending on how much is the return from that crop. Because if you are using a method which is very sophisticated, but the crop value is very low, in that situation, you might not be able to get the return from the crop which is commensurate with the investment which you have made. So that aspect will be very important in some cases where your crop value has to be looked into. It has to be taken into consideration. Because why are you going for artificial irrigation? Because you want to have a security in terms of the water availability. If the nature is not providing water, you are trying to replenish the deficit, the moisture deficit in the soil, whenever it is going beyond a certain limit. So you are trying to replenish that in an artificial manner. But the control with which you can have the security of this replenishment, it goes very high with high level of investment. But at the same time, you have to look at whether it is justifiable depending on what is the outcome from the total activity. And that outcome is only through the final crop production. So if the crop is not very in the market, you cannot get a very high price from the crop. If it's a very low price crop, you can take more risk, because even if it fails, you're not losing much. So from that angle, it has a bearing on the method of irrigation, which method of irrigation you should use can also be affected by the type of crop you are having in question. Cropping machinery. Processes that has to be kept in mind. So sometimes, depending on what type of implements you'll be using, you'll have to take that into consideration while deciding on which method of irrigation you should be using. For example, if you are using a method, suppose you are having a tractor which is using an implement which has this much width, or for in the end when you are using a combine for harvesting, it will have some width which is covering. So if you are using the sizes of the fields which are not multiples of these widths, you might find that the operations will be more expensive, because in some cases, if you're having, this is the size of your field. So in this case, to cover this whole area, you'll have to go once, and then the next time you'll be only covering half the area. So it's not a multiple of the width of the implement which is being used. In the beginning itself, when you're designing your method, you'll have to keep this in mind. Otherwise, the operations will be more expensive. You'll have to put in more labor, or more number of hours will have to be spent to cover the same area. So those things are also now becoming important when you are designing the method. You are looking at these requirements also. You'll also look at where will be the turning strip where the machine will be taking a turn. Is that area available somewhere or not? If it's not available, then it has to be provided. Otherwise, you might be, in terms of the time taken, in terms of the efficiency of the operation, it might be creating problems. There are so many other factors which can influence. For example, the labor availability. Can also be a factor which can influence the type of method to be used. There are some methods which need less amount of labor. There are some methods which need more labor. There are some methods which need unskilled labor. There are some methods which need skilled labor. So if you go in for a method which needs skilled labor, and if the skilled labor is not available in the near vicinity of that area, then you have problem. You might find that your operations are hampered, or you might have to invest more money in terms of getting skilled labor from far off places, which might not be available at the appropriate time. Because in many situations, whenever the labor is in demand, and the cropping seasons are same, when the cropping season is prevalent in one area, the other area, adjoining area, will also have a similar, because seasons are the same season where the crops are grown. We have the Rabi season, we have the Kharif season. So if the labor requirement is in one area, the labor requirement is also in the same time in another area. So you won't find that the labor will be possible to be obtained from the other adjoining areas. If the labor is not available, it's not available. So from those angles, is very essential that whenever you design a method, you have to look at these requirements, you have to look at whether the labor will be available during that time, or the kind of labor which you require, will it be available or not. If it's not available, you might find that ultimately your operations might suffer, the timing might have to be changed, and changing the timings, you have seen that they have their own impacts. You might have some permanent irreparable damage done to the crop yield. So if the irrigation is delayed, then the yield is going to be affected, which you cannot repair by providing more water later on. That is not possible. So this becomes a very important requirement to be looked at when you are looking at which method you are going to employ. Then the local customs. And preferences of the farmers. Invariably, you will find that you may keep on saying that yes, this particular crop is very good for the area. There will be many other factors which will influence what is being grown in the area. The factors can vary from the individual requirement of the farmer. Well, most of the farmers in India, they are marginal farmers. The farmers with very small land holdings, and most of them are doing farming to fulfill their own requirements. Along with them, if there is some surplus production, they might sell it. But basic requirement is what is a major factor in most of their cases, as the areas are very small, the holdings are very small. So in that situation, they'll try to go in for those crops which they can use themselves, and the additional the surplus can be sold. These are the customs have developed from those requirements. So they don't want to leave the customs. They don't want to listen to the various advices which are given to them. They will take their own time. They might take. And once the irrigation water has been made available to them, they might have to wait for 2-3 years before they get a full confidence that yes, whatsoever is being recommended, it can fetch them more money, it can be more useful, they can get a better return. Only then they might change. So many a times, there might be a gap between what is the best and what is being grown in the specific area. Those factors also, many times, they are the influencing factors. They don't want to change the methods of irrigation, because in some cases, either it requires more investment, because if the method of irrigation is such that it needs the grade to be very, very smooth, the grade to be very good. When we say grade to be very good, means that the leveling of the area should be very perfect. So in that situation, they have to invest more. They'll have to go in for maybe the land farming, which will require some more investment. And they don't want to indulge in that. So they will stick to their old methods, because they know that though they might be using more water, they might be losing some water, they are not bothered because of various reasons. Maybe because of the fact that the water is available at hardly any price. They don't have to pay anything for that water. So there are many factors which go into the socio-economic factors, the factors which are beyond the scope here. You might not know what are the real reasons, but there are many different factors which influence the actual prevailing methods, what methods are being used, how they, and whether they, even if you will tell them that yes, these are not the good methods, either they don't have the money to invest or they don't want to invest that money because there's no benefit, direct benefit they feel, because if their water is getting wasted, they are not paying much for that, so it's not a situation where they are losing a lot of money directly. So you have to, and that is not the scope of this particular subject right now. We are only looking at what is scientifically true, whether we can implement that or not. Those are things which are beyond the scope here. But in general, it has been felt that people have started understanding. They have seen that in some cases where more water is being applied, there are some problems which are cropping up, the problems of water logging, the problems of salinity. And because of that, they have started understanding these things, because their interest is in question now. So now, let's go to the various methods at this level. What are the various methods of irrigation which are Let's try to look at the classification of irrigation methods. There are many different nomenclatures which have been put forward. There are various ways people will classify these methods. There is not a unique method or unique way by which you can club these methods, various methods. I'm just using one which I feel is quite a reasonable one under the present circumstances, with the availability of the methods which we have, which are being practiced. We can club them into surface, or we might, to make it more clear, we can call them surface or gravity irrigation. So this will include all those methods which use this phenomena of the gravity flow, and the water is being applied on the surface of the field. In the second category, we can put those methods where you are not applying the water on the surface of the field. You are putting the water in such a manner that it is coming through the subsurface source. So that we can call that group of methods, we can term them as subsurface irrigation. Then another category where we are using the water which is being supplied to the fields is under pressure. So we'll call them pressurized irrigation. Okay. In this situation, I'd like to differentiate a situation where you might be pumping some water and putting into the canal. In that case, it wouldn't become a pressurized irrigation, because ultimately the water is taken to the fields under the flow of gravity. You might be only tapping that water from a lower point and pumping it to take it to the head end of the canal, or maybe augmenting the water into the canal by the pumping. That in general is known as lift irrigation, but that is not a method of irrigation. That lifting is only a part of augmenting the water which is being made available in the irrigation network. At some point you might put some more water into the canal. If the canal water which you are getting from the other sources, if it is coming from the diversion from a river, or if it is coming from a dam, if that is not sufficient, you are augmenting that water by putting some water from a lower level into this canal through a lift irrigation, through the lifting of that water through the pumping. That wouldn't be called the pressurized irrigation. Pressurized irrigation, here we mean those methods where we are using the pressure, the water under pressure is being made available when it comes to the field level. Okay, so the category of methods which we are having under this pressure irrigation is the drip irrigation and the sprinkler irrigation. Under these three broad categories which I just listed, we'll start with the surface irrigation. Surface irrigation methods. The various methods which are available under surface irrigation methods. Again, the list can be very long. There can be some local practices which are being followed, because the surface irrigation methods are age-old methods. But now, looking at those methods which have survived the vagaries of time, and they have proven to be very useful, those methods are water irrigation method. Then we have basin irrigation method. We have furrow, or sometime as there's another class of furrow irrigation. It's called corrugation. Corrugation method. These three are the major methods, but there can be some local methods. For example, the contour ditch, or you might have contour levee, these are some derivatives of the above methods, but we'll have a look at them also. But the first three are the major categories of surface irrigation methods which are most popular all over the world. Now, in general, when you talk of the methods which are belonging to the surface irrigation or the gravity irrigation methods category, there are some common characteristics of these methods which can be looked at. And in general, they involve low capital. In comparison to the other methods, the maintenance The maintenance requirement is also not very high. They require low maintenance. At the same time, the attributes, there are some attributes which you must look at before you decide for these methods. In general, you will find that they require more water. The requirement of water should be unless you have adequate water, you might find that these methods are not suitable. So their requirements in terms of the quantity of water will be comparatively higher. Then they'll also require comparatively smoothness of surface. So whenever you want to use these methods, the fields, the surface on which you are applying the water should be smooth. Only then these methods can be used. You cannot use these methods on undulating areas unless they are leveled, they are graded properly. And those whether you should use a level area or a graded area will be a function of other parameters of the or the other characteristics of the area. Let's start looking at these methods one by one, and then we can discuss their suitability. When we go within the surface irrigation methods and we look at these various forms of surface irrigation methods, where they are suitable. Right now we'll be only looking at their characteristics, and having covered all these methods, having got some feel, got some idea what these methods are about, then we'll go to their design. But how we can design these methods, because each method you'll have to consider some you'll have to come out with the various parameters of those designs, and which parameters are important is a function of which method you're using. So let's first look at the border irrigation. You are using long strips of areas. Which are laid parallel to each other, and these long strips are termed as borders. They will look something like this. Each of these, if you take What is this? This is the field ditch. This is the field channel which is providing water, and let me say that for the water in this channel, and then this is the ridge which is which you can call the cross ridge. Then these are the side ridge. These are the side ridges. So each of these strips is called, this is a border, which is surrounded by the ridges on all the sides. This is another cross ridge. And this can be a collection ditch. Channel. Now, this collection channel, in some cases, it may not be there depending on whether there is any surplus water which is coming to the downstream area or not. And that will be a function of what is the slope of the water. The arrangement is such that you are supplying the water from the field ditch into the each of these borders, either by providing the tubes which are letting the water flow into the borders through the siphon action, or you might make a cut this ridge, and then you can have some control structure here. So through this opening, the water can move into the borders. Now, over these two methods, it is always preferable to use the number of pipes, because of the fact that in case you are using this method, you might find that the waterfront, the way the water will move, it will have an uneven front. More water will be moving in the middle of the border, and in the sides, the waterfront, and the waterfront won't be uniform. Whereas in this case, you might be able to have a waterfront which is uniform. In this case, it will be more preferable, because all these areas, as you go along in the direction of the longitudinal direction of the field, all these areas across, they will get the same opportunity time. So this is the arrangement which you have in the case of water irrigation. And the borders can either be level or it can be graded. So if you have some slope, it will be graded level, graded borders. In that situation, you might find it necessary to have a collection ditch also, which will collect the surplus water. If it that case, the water might not be coming out. You will let the water stay for a sufficient period, and that will be decided by what type of soil you have. If you have clay soils, you might like to give more opportunity time for the water to infiltrate into the soil. But in general, if you try to, let's try to look at the various phases of the movement of water. In general, you will find that there will be a stage where you have advanced curve. This is giving you the way the water is moving from the upstream end to the downstream end. And then you have a recession curve. Gives you the variation, how the water recedes from various locations of the field. Now these two curves are very important in knowing how much is the, at any location of the field, how much is the opportunity time. This is what is called infiltration opportunity. Time. And that is what decides how much infiltration will take place at a specific location of the field. This is the distance from upstream end to the downstream end. And this is the time. Okay. Any question?
Do you like this or all these it will be in the practical condition also this will be similar?
Our question is that is it a theoretical curve or is it being observed in practice also. This is a typical curve which might change when you go from one soil to another soil. So this is, I have just given a typical, but it will belong to some soil. The shape of these two curves, the advanced curve and the recession curve, will change with respect to the other characteristics, like what is the slope of the field, what is the type of soil which you are using. And but in general, you'll find that this is what will be observed in the field also. The shape and the exact curvature, these things will depend on the other, many other properties that we'll see. And that is what is the basic crux of the whole design. When you are saying that you want to design the irrigation method, under a specific irrigation method, what you want to design? You want to design the basic aspect that the infiltration opportunity time should be uniform along the length of the field. That is the basic crux of the, or the basic requirement of the design. If you can keep that infiltration opportunity time as uniform as possible during the, throughout the length of the field, then you have achieved the best possible design. Okay? Thank you.